My congressman Jason Chaffetz likes to talk about how we can no longer run the government on credit cards. Of course, he's referring to the budget deficit and, I guess by extension, the national debt. You know, Republicans on the Hill like to lament the return of big government with President Obama's budget proposals, but the reality is, big government never went away. Sure, Republicans talk a good deal about the need for smaller government and cutting spending, but they never actually do anything to make that happen. It's a campaign gimmick. When they actually get into the government machine, that's when they find out that every government program is somebody's baby, and they all cost money. And cutting government programs is political suicide. Barack Obama talks a lot about making the hard choices and going through the budget with a fine-tooth comb to pick out the waste. I'll believe that when I see it. Because he doesn't write the budget. He can make all the proposals he wants, federal law requires him to, but in the end, it's Congress that's holding the purse strings. They say what goes in and what comes out, and once it gets on the president's desk, he can do all the combing he wants and point out waste and inefficiency until the cows come home, but there's nothing he can do about it because he doesn't have the power of a line item veto. All he can do is sign it, veto it, or let it die on the table. And because the people don't like it when government isn't functioning, he's more than likely going to sign that thing. The omnibus bill, with all its pork, is a perfect example. He blew it off as last year's business, and while he could have made a big show of vetoing it and sending it back with instructions to trim the fat, in the end it just wasn't practical. So he signed it and called it flawed. Every budget, spending bill, and earmark, regardless of whether Democrats or Republicans are in the majority, is going to get signed by the president, again, Democrat or Republican, because one congressman's pork is another congressman's vital public program, and if you cut it out, you will pay for it, politically. So, what's the solution to this problem? The right says cut taxes and spending, the old starve the beast philosophy. Well, what happened the last time we cut taxes? Did government get smaller? No. In fact, thanks to 9/11 and our perpetual war on terror, government got bigger than ever. Under a Republican administration, no less. And were those tax cuts rescinded to meet the costs of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan? No. The administration just said, Iraq's oil revenue will pay for it. And Bush pushed for even more tax cuts. By the way, whatever happened to all that oil revenue? The fact of the matter is, even without the war on terror, government wouldn't have gotten smaller. Tax cuts are very popular with the voters, but it would have made more fiscal sense to take the budget surplus that we had in 2000 and were projected to keep having for years to come and continue to use it to pay off our debt. In 2000, public debt was actually decreasing. We owed about $5 trillion back then. It has since more than doubled, and is going to keep getting bigger. Even if the budget deficit is reduced and gets smaller and smaller every year, we'd still be in the red. The debt would still be growing, just not as fast. Eventually, we might be able to see it decrease again, but that isn't going to happen anytime soon. It probably won't happen with spending cuts, and when the Bush tax cuts for the top brackets expire in 2011, that'll be a marginal increase to the government's revenue, at best. In fact, government programs that could be cut wouldn't make a very big dent in the budget deficit. And those programs that would make a difference are all sacred cows, almost universally agreed to be too important to be cut. Defense, Social Security, Medicare, etc. So, what are our choices, practically speaking? Populist revolt isn't likely to happen, no matter how much some might want it to. Do we default on the debt? What are the consequences of that? I asked around, read a few theories. I didn't like what I saw. The terms chaos and catastrophe were tossed around quite a bit. If we ignore it and keep borrowing and borrowing, that too will result in an economic disaster. What do you think will happen when U.S. government expenditure exceeds the GDP of the entire planet? Again, there are some who would welcome this, or at least claim to. Let it fail. Let's all go back to zero. But practically speaking, they wouldn't like the dramatic change in their standard of living that such an event would cause. So, if we are serious about reducing the debt, but are unwilling to cut spending, what do we have to do? The answer is simple. Raise taxes. We're in the middle of a recession right now. The Recovery Act, slash biggest spending bill in history, has been signed into law. And according to the Keynesian model, this spending will help the economy. We've never tried it to this degree, and with a population that has so much personal debt, or an economy that's more focused on service instead of manufacturing. But whether we were in favor of the stimulus or not, I think we're all keeping our fingers crossed. Taxes have been lowered for the middle class, and the upper brackets have a couple of years before their cuts under Bush expire. Hopefully, by then, the economy will be doing better, which means people will be making more money, which will increase tax revenue, even without raising taxes on the lower brackets. If this is how the scenario plays out, the president will get all the credit, because the sitting president will always get the credit or the blame for the performance of the economy. In a free market, that's absolutely ridiculous, but that's how a lot of Americans think for some reason. This will help President Obama to maintain his popularity, and he would have a very good chance of getting reelected. And that is when the other shoe will drop. Once a president is comfortably serving his second term and no longer has to worry about being reelected, he is free to make unpopular decisions, like raising taxes on everyone. Not only would I not be surprised if this happens, I'd be stupefied if it didn't. And regardless of how unpopular it might be, especially for the most wealthy, I honestly believe that it would be the right thing to do. Especially when we consider the alternatives. For a country with the debt that we have and our collective unwillingness to restrain our spending, it's the only way that we can fix this problem. Reducing the deficit is a good goal to start with. But we need to have an eye toward not only eliminating the deficit, but getting back into a position of having sustainable budget surpluses so we can pay down our debt. On the bright side, if there is one, we don't necessarily have to eliminate the debt. That would mean paying out everybody's investments in U.S. debt instruments, bonds, treasury bills, etc. China, Japan, and Europe, everybody who owns large portions of this debt, they don't want it to go away. It's in their best financial interest to see the U.S. maintain it so they can continue collecting interest. As long as our debt is manageable, say 50 to 75% of our GDP, we can breathe easy. But it's going to be decades before we get back to those numbers, assuming that we're serious about making it happen. It may very well mean that an entire generation of Americans will have to endure a lower standard of living than the one that preceded it. They'll have to make real sacrifices and compromises in the very way they live their lives. We're talking a major paradigm shift in our culture. Really learning to live within our means, to do without some of those toys that we don't need, to focus our priorities in ways that we probably can't even imagine right now. The major political question is, would the president be able to convince the people that this is the right thing to do, or will they resent it and elect a replacement who promises to give them back their money, regardless of the long-term consequences? And that's the optimistic outlook. Who knows what kind of event could happen that would have a major detriment to our economy and our very culture, throwing a huge wrench into how we thought we could handle these problems. It could be a natural disaster, or political or military upheaval in a region of the world with major U.S. interests, merely the peripheral effects of which could stretch the resolution of our economic and fiscal problems over multiple generations. Now, barring any unforeseen catastrophic circumstances, there are economists out there that predict an economic turnaround as soon as the end of this year. I certainly hope they're right. In my opinion, and I'm not an economist, I think things will start to turn around within a year to 18 months, and I consider myself an optimist.